What's happening, guys? Welcome back to the Hunting Challenge. I had the privilege and opportunity to sit down with two well sought after professional hunters that get it done consistently year in and year out. These guys aren't your average hunters. They've been on podcasts throughout the nation. Simply put, they're very knowledgeable about bow hunting big bucks. This is a four-part series, so be sure to subscribe and hit the notifications so you can be notified as I roll out new parts of this series. So with all that said, let's get rolling.
But all that bucks walk with the wind in their nose, all this stuff. I've seen the giant, whoppers just walking in a crosswind this way, just like no care in the world. And you're like, how do you survive this long? Make such a rookie mistake. But it's like, I think they're on high alert. 99.9% of the time, there's a 0.1% where they're tired, lazy, or whatever. I don't know.
There's areas along their trail to and from where they let their guard down, I think.
Yeah.
You know, that they're... If they get into a small pinch and say there's a small ridge or something and they can't see, man, when they're going through that pinch, they're on high alert.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
but yet, if they're in, like, kind of on their travel over there and they can kind of see and smell or just see, I think they can let their guard down a little bit because they can see a lot of what's going on, too.
Deer, in general, a lot of people, you hear their mature bucks don't make mistakes. That's the deer. You know, deer make mistakes. They can't be on high alert 24/7. The anxiety that any animal would have to live like that, you couldn't make it.
If you think about a mature buck, what a mature buck that's been through 5 or 6 years in hunting seasons in a high pressured area, they're basically like a drug lord.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah,
lord is going to screw up.
Yeah.
Eventually in his career, he's going to screw up and he's going to get caught.
Right.
But man, he does everything that has worked for him, and you know what I mean? And and normally what happens to somebody that does get caught, it's a chink. The chink in their armor is somebody or something that they relied on turns their back on them, or something that they relied on to and from that they got a little bit too comfortable with.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And that would be like somebody that squeals on a drug lord or whatever when he gets caught. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. So we... You guys talk
about drug use, but
no, it's the same. But if you think about it, the survival instinct is about both the same.
What you're saying, if they rely on primarily nose and sight, if one of those, which would most likely, in my opinion, be sight, is kind of weakened, they're vulnerable in that situation.
Yeah.
And because they're creatures of habit, they've crossed that area so many times that they get way too comfortable crossing that area, and now their guard's down and you're able to take advantage of that.
Yeah. Yep.
It's essentially what you're saying. So we busted one myth, and that is the October Lull, right?
It's good for selling magazines and everything. and products. Like, you need this for the October Lull.
Exactly. And the October Lull, we talked about this before. Mm-hmm. It is something that a lot of people have to understand. They got to get away from the things, and I think in the last 5 years, with some of the YouTube guys that are doing things,
yeah,
you know what I mean, they're proving that it's not
right.
These guys that got cameras out there all day long and they're hunting, they're proving that it's false. 8 years ago and back, we were driven by, we only had two things: we had magazines and we had TV shows.
Yeah,
and those guys weren't hunting the way we're hunting.
Right,
you know what I mean.
So very few were anyway.
They are giving these deer sanctuaries, because you know what I mean, and they're going to wait until October, late October, when the deer are more active. You know what I mean. But those deer that they were hunting, they would push all these products and everything and these mindsets on us. But none of us realized that, hey, we're not hunting the same type of thing here.
Right.
You know what I mean. What the October lull to me is the pressure has gotten harder and harder and harder. The deer started early season in bedding area A. He got pressured. He went to bedding area B. He went to C, and he went to D.
And they're moving
guys
later.
Guys that set up a tree stand and hunt out that tree stand, according to A, are not making the adjustment for the bucks going up 50 yards farther, 75 yards farther, 100 yards farther. They're not making the adjustment.
Yeah.
They're not seeing the deer. That's why. And their cameras are over there by that thing there. The deer don't come up there until dark.
Right.
Because
right.
You couldn't kill them because you couldn't see them when you're hunting, and also your camera's not getting a picture of them.
What?
That's all it is. People just have never adjusted to the pressure and the movement of the deer as the season progresses. And the reason why people weren't doing it is because they were listening to guys that are hunting big managed pieces of property, and those guys have a philosophy, I'm going to leave a sanctuary for deer. And I'm not, you know, they're not even really hunting much in October.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, I've killed most, I would say 90% of my bigger bucks from October 6th to the 26th, which goes against, and this is years ago, I've always been October guy. I've had more success in October and public than November.
Yeah.
You know, the last 2 years, November's been good, but I've been 30 years, about 30 years hunting. So 29 years hunting, I've killed 4 bucks in October. And only 2 whoppers. So all my big ones come from, you know, from October 6th to the 26th. And right around October 20th, is 18th to the 21st, it's been like perfect for me. Big bucks on the feet, and they're doing what big bucks do. Going through the bed, through the bed, through the bed.
And
I'm gonna wait.
So the other chatter that's out there, we'll call it chatter, is that you can't beat a buck back to his bed in early season. Now, you've mentioned, Greg, that, and well, both of you hunt bedding areas or specific beds early season.
Yeah. Specific,
your specific bed.
Set up over a bed. In marshland, cattail land, it's tough to beat them back to the bed. Gray light, but anything outside of cattails, swamps, flatland, swamps, big woods, mountains, 7 to 7:30 has been when most, I've killed a lot of my bucks over beds, or I've seen a lot of big bucks going into the beds. I'm just, you know, hunting a general area where they might be bedded, like a point or something.
Yeah.
Where they go in there and it's like, all right, but 7, 7:30, way after, you know, it's been light for an hour.
Yeah.
And I think some of these older bucks, that only works if it's the primary bedding area. Like, he knows that whole area. He never gets lost.
Yeah.
You know, so you sneak in, you sneak out, you know, like Todd said, it's one and done.
Yeah.
You know, because he's sooner or later, he's going to catch my boot, my ground scent. You know, even 3 days later, he's like, well, time to go in plan B, you know?
Yep. So a lot of that, too, is pushed by guys. They got 3,000 acres, and they will screw their whole 3,000 acres up if they go in and try to hunt beds in the early season.
Yeah.
They will. So will we. If we're in there and we're hunting deer on beds and on public land, we're going to screw it up too. But we're just going to move on to the next one.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Like, yeah, yeah.
They don't want to push their deer over to their neighbors. And that's what the whole philosophy on all that kind of stuff, and not being able to kill deer in the early season and not being able to kill deer in the morning.
Yeah.
You know, it's all about protecting your area for the perfect time. And for those guys, that's perfect.
Right.
They probably shouldn't. For us, I'm not going to sit back and not hunt.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
Yeah, I'm not going to not hunt in September and October because I want to hunt the rut.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I've been 75% of my deer were killed in the rut.
Yeah.
I was always a rut hunter. Old time hunters were rut hunters. Like, a lot of guys didn't even hunt in October.
So
they,
how?
They took their 2 weeks of vacation in November, and that was when they were hunting, and they were hunting hard.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And it's great because you want to see big bucks running around.
Right.
And you know what I mean? There is,
doing dumb stuff.
Yeah.
Well, it's, you know, over the last several years, I've had more, I'd say, better encounters and more success before even pre-rut. Mm-hmm. Although you do see, I do see or have seen more activity, obviously, during rut. I don't feel like I could be as successful as I am earlier in the season, even through, you know, early October, mid-October. But how would does your strategy change at all going into pre-rut? Say, well, you just said up till the 25th or whatever, October 25th,
yeah,
is when 6th through the 25th.
26th around here, even in the mountain, like northern Jersey, and some of the pine barrens from back in the day when you used to hunt. Halloween, there's that 25th through the 31st, scrapes become just a hotbed.
Yeah.
And then once the first hits, it kind of tapers down. You still get some daywalkers over scrapes. You know, I used to run big old flash cameras over scrapes for, you know, way before it was like, I guess, a thing. You know? And I would get a lot of daywalkers from 25th through like the 2nd. But there's that 5-day window, 3 to 5-day window where it's just like the bucks are just pounding these scrapes. And then it just kind of just tapers off. You get a big one coming through for a second, but usually they've already transitioned into, they know where the does are, and they're just going to be with the does.
Mm-hmm. You
that time frame that he's talking about is also a time frame right up to Halloween, from the 25th or so to Halloween, is a time frame that I absolutely love calling deer. If there's any time that you can call deer, it's then. After that, you don't even know that there's a deer there.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I'll transition into the first week of November after Halloween. I'm going to be hunting does. I'm going to be hunting downwind of does, and I'm going to be hunting like pinch points in between two bedding areas of does. You know, that it's a totally different kind of hunt. But you utilize your whole October to find where the does are bedding.
To get that intel,
you didn't blow the does out. You know that the does are there. The sign that you've used, that you've scouted as you're hunting in, is showing you where the does are at. You've been in a stand and you've seen the does 150 yards get up out of their beds, or, you know, close to there and start making their way to the oaks or whatever. You're utilizing all this information that you gained in October to find the doe bedding areas, and then you hunt pinch points, really.
Yeah. That's why scouting on your way out, in and out, is super important, especially for public land guys. Yeah, the bigger pieces, you know, because does will shift their bedding for food. Like, as the food changes, their bedding will change. Mm-hmm. So if you're hunting this one doe bedding area in, say, mid-October, and it's acorns, so why they're bedded there, and you wait till November to go in there, and if that acorn crop or that ag, whatever they're eating, is gone, you might burn 3 sits waiting for these does to come back, and those does aren't even bedded there. So that's why getting down and really scouting your way out and being, you know, very observant of what you're doing, what you're seeing, is crucial. I think the guys that have a lot of success in public are always learning. You know, they're always just, they're walking, they're looking. Down, looking up, looking around, looking for food.
Yeah.
And I always struggle with food, and I'm trying to really learn how to browse, you know, because I have browse lines on trails. There's a lot of nipping here. Usually that's a doe group. You just fall back, and I was like, oh, look, they're bedding over here for some reason, be it pressure or whatever. So it's like, okay, you know, and added that to my bag of tricks
the
last couple years. And I've had some success now in November because of that.
Okay.
So another thing too, I think that a lot of people, and I'm trying to do this a little bit more as the years go on, you know, the bumper crop of acorns, you know, that year, bow hunters in the past and younger bow hunters they want to have that bumper crop. They want that bumper crop. This is going to be a great year for acorns, and it's going to be a great year. Some of the things that I've learned over the years, first of all, I think most people are starting to get this. Bumper crops absolutely suck for deer hunting. Again, as bow hunters, we kill deer from, the only time we get to kill deer, the only way we generally kill deer is from their beds to their food source. We get to get somewhere in between there, and we kill them. That travel route is how we kill them, outside of the rut. The rut, there's going to be some bucks that are traveling, you know, just randomly. I don't think they do anything really random, older ones. You have to decipher, like, okay, if this is a bumper crop year and you're scouting for the rut, you're hunting a buck or bucks, and you're in a bumper crop. A lot of times, if you're in like a ridge that is just loaded with oaks, and you can hear them falling and everything, in October, early October to late October, especially here in Jersey, our browse is still high. You know what I mean? The leaves haven't dropped. The brush leaves, you know, the low stuff, definitely has got all their leaves still.
Yeah.
Does aren't necessarily bedding where they normally would have cover, or for the other 300 days of the year,
roughly
350 days of the year when there's no acorn, that amount of acorn dropping. They will literally, if this is an oak flat over here, they will literally, if the first available cover is right here amongst them, amongst the acorns, and it's where they can bed, they'll go bed right there.
Yeah.
So you have no travel if you're trying to hunt and kill these things.
Right.
But you have to decide, like, when you kick a doe group up out of that, you have to decide, okay, why are they bedding there? Is this where they're going to be bedding in November? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or not.
Yeah.
Because that could be like a false, just this food source right now, these 2 weeks, while this ridge is on fire.
Right.
Bedding. That's not necessarily, but your winter scouting is going to show you where the does normally are going to bed. You know what I mean? And those are the bedding areas that you want to be in November, because the brown, that cover is going to fall, and they're not going to be bedding there. So you can't necessarily always read on bumper crop years.
Well, I'll add to that here, as because baiting's legal what Todd was saying, they literally bed right off the food. I mean, I don't bait, but I got friends that do, hunting buddies that do, and they're always blowing does off their bait pile walking in. So these does only bed 70, 80 yards, usually 100 yards away from a bait pile. If you have 30 bait piles in the woods, doe groups get scattered. There's not a lot of movement in the rut, you know? So it's difficult to hunt the rut here sometimes, you know, because it's just as flat. There's no terrain forcing them, like in the, you know, I'll use Millville. It's relatively flat.
Yeah.
So there's nothing forcing the deer to go around. So if these doe groups, this one's bedding off these two bait piles, they don't really move much. So bucks, it's a hard for these bucks to, you know, there's really no direct line or anything. So it's a very difficult time to hunt sometimes. You know, I think that's why I struggle in Jersey, because a lot of people bait where I hunt, and doe groups just don't move. So bucks, you know, it's like a very stressful time for me.
Yeah, yeah. Todd, you just mentioned doe bedding in correlation to food and also cover. Mm-hmm. And how have you noticed how that changes throughout the season from early through up through what rut as far as does? Actually, you know what? Forget early season. Let's just go pre-rut and rut.
Okay, so I think by the time the pre-rut's coming in, the cover's starting to fall a little bit. So the areas that may have been food-based or temporary-based bedding that they had that were close to those oaks, they just went 40 yards away from the tree that's fallen today, you know, because there's cover right there. Those aren't primary bedding areas for anybody.
Okay.
But they work for them when they want to be that first group that hits that white oak that's fallen today mm-hmm. or whatever. And the cover's there, and it might be open cover where they can see around. As the season goes on and you start getting into the pre-rut, they're going to be back into their normal beds by then.
Okay.
Beds that work generally most of the year for them. From what in my experience. And then that's going to be where your primary scrapes are at, are going to be close to those areas. So if you got something that you think is a doe beds, where you're finding doe beds in the wintertime in the circular areas and all mm-hmm. that kind of stuff, there's usually a correlation somewhere close to there where there's a scrape.
Okay.
You know, it's going to be an area where there's a lot of crisscross of trails for them to go back and forth to their beds. Maybe two doe groups, one beds over here and one beds over there, and their trails kind of intersect. There's going to be scrapes or something along there. And those are going to be every year. They're going to be in the same type of areas unless there's something major that happens as far as like a timber cut or
right.
you know, something like tree
stand. And that's typically going to be determined by cover or food.
Cover or something that works for that doe group. There's generally going to be cover no matter what, but something that they can survive there. You know, it's an area that they know they can stay away from human pressure, or they can monitor human pressure from where they're at. You know, we all walk it. We all have walked up on a doe group, and we got within 10 yards of them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then they blow out of there. You know. So.
The other thing that you mentioned earlier, I mean, it's no secret that South Jersey's flat, right? Mm-hmm. Obviously, I've hunted very little up in North Jersey, where you have, you know, I guess that's part of the Appalachian Trail and all that stuff, but. Do thermals play a role even in flat country?
Absolutely. Deer, an old timer told me years ago. I mean, I was hunting the Pine Barrens at the time. I was maybe 19, hunting with the club. Old timers, like, deer live and die by the thermals. And you don't know what all that means back then. Like, I don't even know what the hell's a thermal.
Mm-hmm. It was underwear.
Yeah, that's how I'm like, all right. And as I've gotten older, you know, and hunting with other guys who do thermals, like my dad, you know, hunt high in the morning, you know, thermals go up. And it's like, you start reading on thermals. I think now with social media, you see other hunters that can break down thermals pretty well.
Yeah.
And a big buck will literally live and die by thermals. He knows a thermal pool in the area, what it's going to do no matter what, there's high winds. He knows this area is safe to move in because the thermal is going to take all this and kind of loop back around. We've all hunted and have a buck or a deer come in. You're like, man, I'm going to come right in. Throw off some milkweed or a little powder thing. It's going this way. And next thing you know, they just stop 60 yards out. And you're like, what's going on?
Right.
Something happened. And usually that's their thermal's getting pulled down to them. And they just, we've all watched them big bucks just learn to stop in their tracks and just go. I'm good.
Yeah.
Back right up, come where I'm coming from, you know?
Yeah.
So thermals are important. Understanding thermals with different wind directions, different terrain features. You know, pine trees can affect thermals, you know, real thick.
Dark.
Yeah, it's going to, you know, pull wind and go around rocks, you know, open areas. You know, you got some pine trees over here, you got this sun over here. Well, that's just creating, you know, shady and warm spots. So understanding thermals is crucial to be, if you can understand, you can kill a lot of deer.
Right. Would you add anything else to that?
Thermals, for me, the thing that I've seen, you know, Greg hunts, you know, North Jersey, put some time up there in the hills. Around here, for me, the thermals, for the most part, like in the evening, the first few minutes of light and the last few minutes of light is where thermals affect things for me. Like, most nights in bow season, you could have a 10-mile-an-hour wind right up to the last 45 minutes. And as soon as the sun starts to go behind Pennsylvania, you know what I mean? And it's the wind will die. And then thermals, to me, thermals start pulling then the most. And that's generally the time when the bigger deer are going to, you're going to give me an opportunity in the evenings or whatever. And water, for me, like I'm generally always close to water. Mm-hmm. So the water, you know, things are going to pull towards that water. So you got to be mindful of it.
Right.
And, you know, if you're in an area, I don't know if Greg ever does this or not, but you could hunt the wrong wind all night long, waiting for that thermal pull in the evening to be right at the right time. If you understand what I'm saying, mm-hmm. Like that wind could be going in the wrong direction where that you expect the buck to be coming from. As long as it's not blowing to where you think he's at right now.
Right.
It could be the wrong wind all afternoon, but you're waiting for that last 45 minutes or half hour, and it's right for you then. You know what I mean? So you could set up for that.
That's living by my thermals.
Yeah.
In the salt marsh, I'll get that a lot. I know that the last, say, 2 hours of light, tide's going to be out, and it's baking that mud. I'll literally wait till the last 2 hours of light, and then I'll sneak in, like Todd's saying, and I know that the wind's going to die down, and all that big open mud flat, you know, with all that heat, as soon as that cools down, it's going to, like, I mean, I've had it zip down, the milk would go right to it, and it's a great spot. I've had so many deer come in, you know, nothing we're shooting, but perfect strip. Never knew I was there.
I think a lot of guys do, like when you get something major like water or mud flats he's talking about, where there's such a thermal pull, a lot of guys will think that, why'd the wind change? Because it can be almost like the breeze we're feeling right now.
Yeah.
Thermals can be that hard.
Uh-huh.
On big thermal pull areas like that. So guys think that the wind just changed, but it actually died down and now thermals are taking over and they're actually stronger than the wind was the wind was blowing. You know what I mean?
Remember Dan, an infall in that. The pond stand, he had years ago, he talked about he would come through a pond when the wind was wrong, but he knew, you know, that pond would draw his scent to the water and up, and he would leave, you know, his shooting area, you know, free and clear. You know, it's like a super aggressive tactic, but it's not really aggressive. You know what's going to happen, so you can sneak in, you know, and then have that water take your scent and just go straight up, and then deer never know you're there.
Yeah.
Hills, like draws, same thing, like in the morning. Probably why I like hunting in the morning, some of the draws. You know, you sneak up in, and then your scent just ripping right up. You know, the deer never smell you. You know, even if they're down with you, that thermal pull is just ripping your scent right up. And you're like, I've had in the mountains, I can't believe that doe buck didn't smell me. And then, you know, you're thinking, it just goes down, and it just goes straight up.
So, I love those mornings where it's pulling like that. The only fear I always had is you can't control where that wind is. It's going to come back down.
Yeah, right, right, right.
Like, where is
right,
it coming back down? Right. Like, I love dropping milkweed or a puffer and see it go like this on your tree stand in the morning.
The worst.
You know what I mean? But eventually, whatever goes up has to come back down. Where is it coming back down?
Right.
You know, these are going up and then going 100 yards and then dropping and going in where you expect the deer to go. So I almost would rather not have that pull up sometimes. But I love it. It feels good.
Yeah.
You feel invincible. Yeah. But it doesn't necessarily, you always got to kind of think like, where is it ending though?
The worst for me, like when dealing with thermals and milkweed, you're sitting in the stand, you're like, just pull out, and Lori just goes
straight down.
Down to your tree.
That's
the worst. Straight down.
And deer ain't moving. If they are, they're super high alert, and there's nothing giving them advantage. Everything's going straight down. It's like, those mornings like that, I'm like, I don't even want to be in the woods because I feel like I'm just giving up. You know what I'm trying to do, the deer onto me, especially the does, or your ground tents is kind of just in this weird pattern. It's like,
yeah, you drop one time and it gets right down where the tree starts to fatten out at the dirt.
Yeah.
And the roots start, you know, and it goes this way slowly. Yeah. This time you drop another one and it goes that way.
Yeah, like around the
same. What am I doing?
It's contaminating the whole area. Yeah. It's like, let me just get out of here.
Yeah. So, and I've come to prefer like that 8 to 10 mile an hour wind, you know, just
slight steady wind. Yeah. And I think for deer too, that's been consistent. They're more inclined to move in their normal pattern. We all hunt swirling winds and weird wind shifting. Them deer just super cagey, you know, or wired, and bucks will just, I'm just not moving. And even does. I mean, you know, walking, they're all doing this stuff. It's like, yeah. I'm afraid to eat. I won't even shoot a deer, buck or doe. That's
high alert.
Yeah, it's like they're going to drop usually. And I'm just not comfortable taking that shot.
All right, so that's a wrap for this segment of this four-part series. Let me remind you one more time, for the next 30 days, anybody that subscribes to my channel, I will donate $1 to Bowhunters United. So be sure to subscribe and hit that notifications bell and be on the lookout for the next part of this series. Appreciate y'all watching. See y'all.